All right. Hi, everybody. I'm Alessandra, and it's a joint work with Payman and Mike. Payman from Visa Research, and Mike from Oregon State University. So in this work, we are interested in zero knowledge proofs for RAM programs. And we are interested in specific properties. And I'm going to try to motivate this property with, I'm going to start with an example. So say that you have some server who has some interesting data. It does not have to be medical data. It can be any kind of data, demographic or any kind of data. And say you have customers who are willing to pay to query this data. So we are looking at any kind of query, so we model the query as any kind of program, so any kind of RAM program. So the client can query, ask a query, get an answer, and can do it many times. In fact, we envision to have even many customers. Now, of course, naturally, the client gets the answer, and the client wants to make sure that the answer is correct, and in particular, that all the answers are computed on the same data. Now, this proof has to be zero knowledge, because here we are trying to protect the data of the server, because the server is trying to sell its data, so we cannot just give the data away, so this proof has to be zero knowledge. This is not a delegation problem. Now, for this kind of problem, what can we say about this proof, this zero knowledge proof? So we want the following property. The first one is an efficiency requirement. The work to compute this proof should be only dependent on the running time of the program. So from the customer point of view, the customer is paying for a certain program, so it does not want to pay more to get this proof. From a server point of view, the server is paid only to run this program, so it's not in its interest to kind of do some additional overhead, some additional computation for this money. So we really want to make sure that if that this proof has only be proportional to the running time of the program itself. The other requirement we have is a security requirement. We are looking for kind of the strongest security we can achieve, which is composability. Now, well, also we have other requirements like cost of round. We only want a number of round that is constant, which is, I'm not going to stress on it, it's going to be implicit throughout the talk. So now, for those of you who know zero knowledge, you are thinking, first, I've seen this problem already. And second, I thought we've solved this problem by now. So this is indeed a problem which goes under the umbrella of sublinear zero knowledge. And we do know from the 90s that there is a long line of work which is trying to make proofs which are as short as possible. So in this line of work, we really care about the verifier running time. So these proofs are so short that these days you can also have, you can have only constant number of bits sent for a proof. The problem here is that the work of the prover is always proportional at least to the input size. And this is kind of against our efficiency requirement, because we want that the prover should only work as much as is required by the program, by the RAM program. So, and particular in this line of work, the main problem is that this is kind of a circuit-based approach. So every time you have a circuit-based approach, you have to work at very least as much as the input size. So now the next natural question is, well, again, we have solved this already. Instead of looking at circuit, can we consider the RAM model of computation? So can we look at all RAM solutions? So if you guys are not familiar with ORAM just means that instead gives us a way that so that instead of working with the entire circuit, and so with the entire input, we can do computation which depends only on the running time up to a logarithmic factor. And indeed, there exists a work which is called sublinear amortized zero knowledge, which is based on ORAM. And this was this is by Hu, Mohassel, and Roslek. It was shown in CRIPA 2015. And they, so they achieved zero knowledge, sublinear zero knowledge. So the idea, their proof works in two phases. First, there is a setup phase, where the verifier and the prover do some computation to preprocess the data. And then after that, each proof, it's very short in the sense that it's only proportional to the running time. So the idea here is that every time there is a proof involved, the verifier, every time the prover has to prove that the computation was correct, the verifier is going to compute a bunch of garbled circuit. It's going to send the garbled circuit to the prover, And the prover is going to compute this garbled circuit on its own data. And this gives the verifier a guarantee that the output is correct, because the garbled circuits are coming from the verifier. Now, the positive side of this construction is that in each proof, both the verifier and the prover only have to compute this T garbled circuit. But the downside of this solution is that we still have to deal with a very expensive setup phase. There is no reason why the verifier needs to work so hard in the setup phase. So in this work, we are trying to avoid that. So we are trying to make sure that the only work of the verifier is only proportional to the running time. I would like to mention that there are other works of zero knowledge for the specific programs, like zero knowledge sets or other kind of specific queries. These works are very, very efficient. But in our case, we are looking at more general question. We are looking at run programs. All right, so this is the state of the art. So what do we do in this paper? We are actually achieving what we promised. So we provide the first kind of zero knowledge for run programs, and the work is only proportional to the running time. The setup phase is succinct, is independent on the input size, and it's UC secure. And the nice thing is that it's only based on what we call efficient, the theoretical cryptographers say efficient. So garbled circuit or Zkeyboo, which is a new way to implement zero knowledge proofs. Now, before we move on to the technique, I want to stress what UC secure means in this setting. What it means to have a protocol which has CVC security. So this means that we have to implement the ideal functionality, the zero knowledge ideal functionality. And in this setting, the ideal functionality is modeled as follows. So there is an initial phase where the prover has to commit to the entire data set. And this is done once and for all. And later on, every time the prover needs to prove some statement, the functionality will run the statement for we'll run the program for on the committed data, we'll update the data, and give the output to the verifier. Now, the challenge here in achieving UC security is that we have the simulator. At some point, we'll have to give this data to the ideal functionality, but I'm requiring that the transcript should not depend on the input size. So somehow, we have to work a little bit harder to extract this input from the prover. In particular, it's not that we have to work harder, we have to restrict the kind of assumptions we can make. We need some extractability assumption that is given either by tamper-proof hardware, which we're not using, or by random oracle. And we are, in fact, using, in this paper, we're using non-programmable random oracle to extract the input of the prover. All right, so that's our goal. So let's see what is our technique. So our starting point is indeed the sublinear protocol by Hu et al. Because as I said, it has a very, very nice properties, especially in terms of primitives used. So it's only using very efficient one-way function and garbled circuits. So let's now find out why they need the setup phase and how we can get rid of it. So the setup phase in this paper consists, it's a phase where the prover and the verifier needs to encode the input, needs to commit the input. So the way it works is that there is a two-party protocol where the prover participates with this input and the verifier participates with garbled information, so with randomness to encrypt the input. Then during the protocol, the input is first transformed in ORAM 4. And second is garbled. At the end of the protocol, the prover gets the garbled version of the memory, of the data, and the verifier does not get anything except the guarantee that now the data is committed and is encrypted under the randomness that was chosen by the verifier. Now, why does this help? This helps because later on, when the prover has to prove, for example, the output of program RI, the prover will run the program in his head, will send the access pattern to the verifier, and now the verifier can prepare the garbled circuits, that have to access to those locations. And the verifier can prepare this garbled circuit because he knows that the memory was encrypted using the randomness provided by the verifier. So it's kind of, the verifier can already prepare this garbled circuit so that the prover can directly evaluate them by just looking at the data. So the prover is going to take just the encoded memory, plug it in the garbled circuit, evaluate the garbled circuit, and here it goes the output. And now the verifier can check the output and is guaranteed that the output is coming from the encrypted database, the committed database. Now, after this evaluation, the verifier and the prover needs to replace the garbling that have been used. And this is basically the description of the entire protocol. Now, one thing we have to observe, crucially, the soundness here is kind of based on the fact that the verifier controls all the garbling. So the verifier controls the encoding of the data. And this is why there is a setup phase, because the verifier has to encode the entire data. Now in this work, we want to get rid of it. So we want to say the verifier should do nothing. That's nice, but of course we are going to run into soundness problems. And so the main contribution here is to figure out how can we, how can we fix all the soundness problem once you don't have the help of the verifier to encode the data at the beginning? So how do we do it? So that's what we want. We want that at the very beginning there's a setup phase which is short. And basically all the encoding must happen in the head of the prover. So the prover will be in charge of taking the data, constructing the ORM, encode, encrypt the ORM, and finally, we'll just commit to all this value using the Merkle tree. The only thing that the verifier sees is the tree of Merkle tree. All right. Once we have this approach, what is going to happen is that now, whenever the prover needs to evaluate the garbled circuit, first of all, the verifier does not know the garbling, the inputs that are used by the prover, so the prover is going to have to ask for labels by OT, and the prover is going to give an input to the garbled circuit some information that was never processed by the verifier. All right? So, in this new model, we have the following challenge. First of all, how does the verifier know that the input that the prover is providing to the garbled circuit is actually consistent with the hash, the tree root that the verifier has? So that's the first challenge. And importantly, we have to prove this consistency in a black box manner because we are going to deal with random oracle, and you cannot use the code of the random oracle. Besides, it's also very inefficient to have no black box proofs. So that's the first problem. The second problem is we have to make sure that the way we ask, the way the encoding works is such that any simulator can extract the actual data. And so we have to come up with a commitment scheme, which is extractable and equivocal, of course, you see. But crucially, it has to be non-interactive. Because all the commitment has to happen in the head of the prover. We don't want the prover to have to interact with the verifier in order to commit. So that's important. The last problem we are going to encounter is actually has to do with ORM. Even once we extracted the entire, even if the simulator extracts the entire input which is committed, this input is in ORM form. Now the question is, once I have the ORM form of the input, is it easy, is it trivial to reconstruct the original version of the input? We would think yes, but it turns out that the prover, so the ORM schemes are made to be used by honest people. We never think of a client of the ORM being dishonest. So we have to be careful because the prover can cheat in the ORM in a subtle way and create states which are ambiguous, such that the simulator does not really know what is the actual input that the prover intends to use. So these are the three challenges we are going to deal with. I'm going to go over the first one more in details, and the other two I'm going to go very, very quickly. All right, so how do we prove, how do we allow the prover to prove that the input given to the Galois circuit are the same as the ones that are committed in the Merkle tree? All right, so in order to solve this problem, we are going to use techniques that have been developed already in Stock 2014 and TCC 2014 for another problem. But the idea is that when you want to provide a black box proof of a commitment value, one idea is instead of committing the value right away, you will first encode the commitment using an encoding scheme like Lipselmo, and then you'll commit each share independently. So you first have this pre-processing of your data, and then you compute the Merkle tree. So if the data is committed in this way, then the prover is able to actually show the verifier that he's being honest without revealing too much. How does this work? So now the prover is going to feed the Galois circuit with the code word of a value instead of the value directly. The Galois circuit will check that everything is okay and will compute the new encoding, and later it will output for the verifier to see. It will output some values of the code word, not all of them, only some of them. And these are just for the verifier to see. So now the verifier receives this partial information from the Galois circuit. The next step is to connect this partial information with the committed root. How to do that? This is simple. We just ask the prover to open the path that corresponds to the location which we're giving an input to the Galois circuit. So now the verifier sees the code word that is the Galois circuit saw, and at the same time, he obtains the code word from, well, the partial code word from the commitment. He can check the two things, and if they are indeed the same, the verifier is convinced that the prover is computing over the input that was committed at the beginning. So there is a proof of consistency, and the nice thing is that the verifier does not have to do anything about it. It's just checking. We generalize this idea can be generalized. You don't really need garbled circuits, or you don't necessarily need garbled circuits. All we need is to compute this F-check functionality, and you can implement this functionality in any way. In particular, you don't need garbled circuit N of T. You can use other techniques like Zikibu that I was mentioning before. All right, so that's the first challenge. The second challenge was just commitment scheme, but we have no time for the second challenge. I just wanted to go very briefly the second challenge was just, okay, let's come up with a commitment scheme which is UC and non-interactive. If you have questions, you can ask them later. Now, the third challenge is what happens even after the simulator was able to decrypt everything, to extract all the information. Is it possible that the simulator gets confused? Is it possible that the prover can commit to an ambiguous ORAM, which is still correct? To give you an example why this is possible, consider the following ORAM state. This is a path ORAM state, so you have a position map, and you have the ORAM tree. The position map tells you how to map the real blocks with the physical blocks, so the logical block with the physical blocks. Now, in this case, for example, the position map tells us that if you want the block 4, you have to look at path 1. But if you go to path 1, you see there are two blocks which are indexed by 4. So now the simulator that sees this, so this is not illegal. Path ORAM will allow you to do that. Well, the client will not do that, but this is legal. But now the simulator, by seeing this information, will not be able to actually understand what is the actual block that you should commit. So this is just a very subtle issue, and we define a new property for ORAM that we need, which is called extractability. And all it says is that you have to make sure that from the state of the ORAM, there should be a unique database, a unique memory that you can extract. All right, so in conclusion, putting everything together, we provide this new way to do RAM proofs for program, zero-knowledge proofs for RAM programs. And the interesting fact, I guess, that it's based on very efficient primitives, it's UC secure, and the work depends only on the running time. Thank you.